Hopefully, this will make them listen. Can't delete this, but I'm not sure if you could anyway.
Shut up, Michael Paul.
I think you're allowed to delete the ones that you send, but I'm pretty sure you have to suffer this. Either way. Shout out to Mr. Peterson.
One of the things that people are very much confused by in the modern world is what archaic people meant by gods. And that's because whatever the deities were that had the motive force that archaic people attributed to the gods seem to have disappeared in modern culture. Now, the Jungian hypothesis is that's because they turned into psychological traits, fundamentally, or motivational forces. So what archaic societies would describe as gods, we would describe as motivational forces. So, for example, Venus is a goddess of love, and we would associate her power with love and sex, fundamentally. And the reason that that's a reasonable association from the archaic standpoint is because the motive quality that makes up what Venus represents is transpersonal, which means it's not limited to one person, and it's immortal in that the motive force that characterizes sexual affiliation exists whether or not a single individual exists. So it's transpersonal, has the force of a personality, because if you fall in love, you're motivated by a certain set of standards and perspectives, right? If you're gripped by beauty, say, or if you're gripped by lust, that imposes a particular view of the world on you and impels your actions, sometimes despite your will. And so that would be equivalent from the archaic perspective to possession. And it's clearly the case that archaic societies who were engaged in warfare, for example, would conduct rituals to ensure that the warriors that made up their societies were in fact possessed by the correct god. So it might be Mars, for example, the Roman god of war, so that on the battlefield they exhibited the proper characteristics of somebody who was in a battle, right? Rage, you can think. Rage. So possession by the god of war would be equivalent to this possession by a state of rage. Now, it's not quite that simple. It isn't only that archaic people externalized motive forces and gave them the status of deities. What they did was more complex than that, and I think you can understand that a little bit better if you start to give some thought to the modern behavioral notion of the stimulus. Now, the stimulus is a very, very weird concept, because the behaviorists who weren't interested in taking apart what was inside the brain would attribute motive force to the stimulus, right? They'd say, if you present an animal with a stimulus, he will therefore act. And that meant that the behaviorists were making the presupposition that the motive power resided in some manner in the stimulus. Well, why would they think like that? Well, it's an archaic mode of thought, in a sense. You can imagine a child saying, one of my friends today made me really angry, right? Which means that the child is essentially conflating his or her own internal emotional state with the proximal stimulus that gave rise to that state. And you see complex associations like that taking place with regards to the apprehension of beauty, say, because beauty is a very, very complex and difficult to localize phenomena. If you're very attracted to someone, are you attracted by them? Well, in a sense, of course, you are, because there they are. But in another sense, you're not at all, because what's happening is that you're engaged as much in the attraction as anything that's motivating you from the outside world. And I think that partly accounts for your sense of foolishness, especially if the person that you're attracted to doesn't return your attraction. I mean, from your perspective, you're attracted and dominated by the object, but by the same token, you know entirely that, easy as it is to presume it's them and their fault, say, it all has to do with you. So in the modern world, where we've been able to separate out the object and the motive force of the object, the deities have sort of moved inside of us and become psychological forces. But you can understand, if you think about it in this manner, that things weren't so clear prior to the dawn of the empirical age. That gives you a little bit of background with regards to what the notion of deity meant to archaic societies who still utilize those notions as explanatory terms. Okay, so we know that if you're caught up in one of these little world games, that you may be motivated by something very, very fundamental, right? A tendency that transcends you, the tendency to propagate yourself, say Freud's fundamental motivational level, sexual affiliation, or the tendency to maintain yourself. Those you could say are the fundamental gods of existence, the fundamental driving forces, and it's there, it's the interaction of those two forces over great periods of time that produce the great diversity of life and human life that we see before us. And each of those fundamental, most fundamental of gods have their differentiated minions, so to speak, so that while engaged in the meta goal of self-preservation, you act out plots of hunger and plots of thirst, and you move from cold to hot or from hot to cold, depending on your particular, on the particular temperature of your surroundings, or with regards to self-propagation, you're attracted to people who are repelled for reasons that are frequently, absolutely beyond your comprehension, by the way. So I just found out this week, and this is absolutely staggering, I think, that if you run an experiment on a group of women and you track their menstrual cycle, and then you give them t-shirts that men have worn to smell, that women who are ovulating like the smell of symmetrical men better than asymmetrical men. So, and that's partly because symmetrical men are probably more healthy, but this is a good example of how the motive forces that configure your world are dependent on instinctual forces that are not only beyond your consciousness, but they're beyond even at the moment any of our explicit explanations. So another finding that's very similar that I came across recently, turns out that mice will not mate with mice that have Rh blood factors that are likely to produce unfit offspring. The more closely genetically related the Rh factors, the more likely there is to be a catastrophe with regards to offspring. And the mice seem to detect the Rh factor by smell. So recently this was run by with women, and it is also the case that women prefer men whose Rh factors are at an optimal distance from them in terms of smell. So this is some example of how these unbelievably archaic systems, because like the olfactory systems are unbelievably archaic, produce alterations in worldview at a level that's massively below consciousness. So underneath your cortical shell, which is tonically inhibiting all your emotional and motivational systems, lies all these motivational and emotional systems, and they have branches that grow up into the cortex, and they have the capacity to control your behavior completely involuntarily. So for example, if you're gripped by fear, it's very, very difficult to overcome that voluntarily, and at least initially you won't be able to, which is to say that when the chips are down, the underlying motivational and emotional systems have control. Okay, so then what happens from that perspective? Then what happens when you encounter something you don't understand? And I think the best way to explain it is something like generalized disinhibition, which is that all your underlying motivational and emotional systems are more or less disinhibited simultaneously. And the reason for that is because you want to be maximally prepared to do whatever the hell is necessary to do when you're somewhere that you don't understand. And because you don't know what that thing is going to be, all your systems go on. And when psychologists talk about stress, which is an abysmal word, right? It means everything and nothing. When psychologists talk about stress, what they mean is generalized disinhibition of emotion and motivation.
Hold you back myself up when nobody else will.
Then you come to the case of ancient Egypt. One of the things Eliade points out, which I think is really interesting, I mean, really phenomenal. The story I'm going to tell you right now was essentially revealed in Egyptian culture at the dawn of the culture rather than developing over the course of the culture. So the Egyptians had a revelation right immediately that the most fundamental of gods was the one who created as a consequence of his tongue and his speech, very much akin to the Sumerian idea with regards to Marduk and also to later Judeo-Christian ideas. So here's the story. There's four players in this drama, okay? There's Osiris, his wife Isis, Horus, their son, and Seth. And Seth is Osiris's evil brother. Okay, now Osiris was a remarkable guy. He was the founder of the Egyptian state from the mythological perspective. So kind of like Romulus and Remus for Rome, a myth, or like George Washington for the U.S., right? A mythologized figure who represented all of the pharaohs and people, for that matter, who'd actually constructed the Egyptian state. Osiris, father of Egypt, so to speak. But Osiris is kind of old and a little archaic and maybe a little bit senile and even possibly a little bit naive in that, even no matter how great you were in your youth, as time goes on, you lose contact with environmental transformations and the old rules that you live by are not necessarily applicable to the present, and some of those things that you ignore become paramount in importance. And it turns out that Osiris has an evil brother, Seth, and Seth eventually turns into Satan as mythology develops through the centuries. And Seth is a nasty guy, right? I mean, what he wants more than anything is undeserved dominion over the Egyptian state. Now, Osiris, because he's not paying attention and because he isn't sufficiently cognizant anymore of the power of evil, more or less ignores his evil brother, who, in turn, chops him into pieces and then distributes his pieces all over the Egyptian state. Now, you might say, why didn't he just kill him, right? I mean, you think chopping him up would kill him, but he's a god. You can't just kill him. The reason in mythology...